Well, good morning, everyone. It's August in Kansas. And we always want a rain, it seems like, in August in Kansas. Occasionally we get plenty. But they tell me the average is pretty high. I always wonder how that works out. But every once in a while we'll get a rain like 4 inches and the average is out pretty good. But I'd rather have about 1 inch a week, but it doesn't go that way in Kansas. But we're excited to be here because no matter what happens, the Lord is with us. We're excited to worship together, whether it's rain or shine. Do we have any announcements? If you look in the back, Gail has put a recipe in the back. She brought one cookie today, but it's a big one. Anyway, the recipe in the back, if you look down there and it says grease a pan, rather than grease a pan, then you have the lucky one. I tried, there's two of them that have that.
Maybe they get an extra piece of cookie.
Maybe get an extra piece of cookie or an extra cucumber. Bill brought us some cucumbers. We've got okra out there. We've got everything. A veritable garden right there in the fellowship hall. Do we have any other announcements? The Harvest Fest is underway. I'll be planning on being here and helping out. If we have a bunch of people helping out, it's not much of a job. If there's three of us that show up to do everything, it's a lot of work. So we need everybody. Any birthdays or anniversaries? No? All right, well, let's go ahead and we'll open up with our beginning song, I Will Call Upon the Lord. It is 202 in your favorite team.
Basically, you sing through it twice and it's still pretty fast.
2002.
Yeah. Oh, okay. It starts with 2002.
Yeah.
Thank you. Well, God, we do continue in our worship of you, and we thank you that you remind us of your kindness each day. We thank you that you send us gifts of beauty. We may see a beautiful sunset, or beautiful moon, or beautiful animals, or birds, and hear beautiful songs. Thank you that you send us those messages, and I pray that we would respond in love and in joy. Guide us now as we listen to your scriptures and as we sing your songs. Guide us with your Holy Spirit, we ask now in Jesus' name. Amen. Our opening psalm is found in Psalm 80, and I'm not going to read the whole thing, but it's a little different. A lot of times we do very positive psalms, and sometimes there's, if you read the psalms, there's some of them that are even agonizing over things, and even angry and vindictive, because it vents the feelings of men and women, and they're sharing their feelings towards God. And many times we learn from these that it's okay to express our feelings towards the Lord and let Him heal us. Starting with verse 14. Return to us, O God Almighty. Look down from heaven and see. Watch over this vine, the root of your hand has planted, that your right hand has planted, the son you have raised up for yourself. The young vine is cut down and is burned with fire. Your rebuke, your people perish. Let your hand rest on the man in your right hand. The son of man you have raised up for yourself. Then we will not turn away from you. Revive us, and we will call your name. Restore us, O Lord God Almighty, and make your face shine upon us, that we may be saved. If you read the rest of the psalm, earlier part of the psalm, you can see how things have fallen apart for Israel. And our theme today is like a hammer. And we'll see how that plays out as we read the scriptures and as we listen to God's word through psalm. Let's sing our next song. It is, Lord, I Love You. I Love You, Lord. 2068, and of the Faith We Sing.
And we'll sing through it twice.
Us.
going to read from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 23. And actually, the last verse of our reading here is the verse that's on your bulletin. Am I only a God nearby, declares the Lord, and not a God far away? Can anyone hide in secret places so that I cannot see him, declares the Lord? Do not I fill heaven and earth, declares the Lord? I have heard what the prophets say who prophesy lies in my name. They say, I had a dream, I had a dream. How long will this continue in the hearts of these lying prophets who prophesy the delusions of their own minds? They think the dreams they tell one another will make my people forget my name, just as their fathers forgot my name through Baal worship. Let the prophet who has a dream tell his dream, but let the one who has my word speak it faithfully. For what has straw to do with grain, declares the Lord? Is not my word like fire, declares the Lord, and like a hammer that breaks a rock in pieces?
Thank you, Jan. And pretty interesting when you compare it to what is going on today in our world. All right, let's sing Amazing Grace. Some of you can sing this without the number, but it's 378 in our handbook.
Verses 1, 2, 3, and 6.
A favorite songs, Amazing Grace, beautiful song. And actually, I once attended a church that they just sang, praise God, praise God, praise God, praise God. And I'm not going to sing solo, I was starting. Reading from Hebrews chapter 11, going through chapter 12, verse 2. They were stoned, they were sawed in two, they were put to death by the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, persecuted, and mistreated. The world was not worthy of them. They wandered in deserts and mountains and in caves and holes in the ground. These were all commended for their faith, yet none of them received what had been promised. God had planned something better for us, so that only together with us would they be made perfect. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart.
Thank you so much, Jen, for reading that. And when we go through trials, we can think, wow, look at what other believers, especially prophets in the Old Testament, in the first ones who begin to preach the gospel faced against the Roman Empire. And so we feel like, man, some of the stuff we put up with isn't so bad. But nonetheless, we have concerns and we have trials that we go through, and we have joy. So does anyone want to share their joys or their concerns today? I think we should continue to pray for those in the Ukraine and those in Russia who don't really want to be involved in this conflict but are forced into it. Who want peace to reign and that the gospel might go forth freely. So let's pray for the Ukraine and for Russia and for all the countries involved. For peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Anything else?
Our son starts a job with the fire department tomorrow, so he's expecting some hazing. And he said, I'm going to be there at right around Gopher for 12 months probably, but there's another young man that's coming on also, so he won't be by himself. It's just that he would have peace and strength to get through, you know, everything. He said there's actually a lot of Christian verses up in this fire department. He thinks maybe the chief is a Christian. But anyway, it's a whole new world. He got his training like January through May, and he's been anxious to use it. So here we go.
Let's pray for Matt as he starts a new career, and one that his heart has led him into. For Matt, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers.
I think we should just thank the Lord for all those who serve us that night, the firefighters, the police, ambulance, all of those.
Let's thank him in a special way, and if they are ever gone, we'll know it. Get a prairie fire, and the fire department says, well, you know, we're just not doing that anymore. All of a sudden, our towns, you know. Let's give thanks for those who serve in that way, for those who take care of our emergency needs. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
And for the beginning of school this week, the kids come and things really start.
Pray for school, for the teachers, and for those who are the kids that they might be ready to learn. For school coming up this week, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We got to see our granddaughter yesterday, and they've got some help. My granddaughter just wants to be held all the time. So Ryan's mom's come up, and there was they sent a picture of both of them very happy, one being held and one being the holder. So we give thanks for that, and that they have support. And our family in India has support. Lord, in your mercy, hear our praise and thanks. All right, well, I know you have things on your mind and concerns. You need to try to focus upon the Lord, that things keep coming up in your mind that you are praying for. I'll give you a moment to talk to the Lord without me coming in with words. But even if I am praying, it's no problem for me if you keep praying on whatever subjects that you have that you need to talk to the Lord about. So let's go ahead and sing our prayer song. Which one is it, Gail?
Serenong, Serenong. 523 in your hymnal. We'll just do the chorus.
523 in your hymnbook, the chorus. Thank you, Father, for your word that speaks to us. Thank you for your presence among us. Thank you that you have given us an abundance. We pray now for those who are suffering in this world, for those in our community that are suffering. We pray that you would bring healing, both spiritually and physically. For those in this congregation that may need healing, I pray that you would bring healing to them as well. We thank you for those who are willing to serve in our governments, local and federal and state. We thank you especially for those that are willing to work and cover in the community and try to do the very best that they can to follow your laws and follow your rules and follow the way that you would have us to live. Bless those who are serving in this way. Keep them safe. Keep them healthy. We pray for those in the state and federal level that are wanting to serve according to your word and according to your ways. I pray that you would bless them for their work and keep them safe. We pray that you would bless our government, that it might rule in a way that honors you. We thank you for those who are truly serving in a way that they want to please you. We pray for those who are protecting our borders, for those who serve in the military. We pray that you would bless them for their work. Keep them safe. Protect them and their families from healthy. We pray for those emergency responders that we talked about that do so much for us that maybe we don't even know or not even aware, but would notice suddenly if they all were gone. We pray that you would bless them for their work, keep them safe and healthy, and provide for them and their families. We pray for those who take care of our utilities, and for those who truck our goods in, and those who raise our crops for the farmers. I pray that you would bless them all for the part that they play in taking care of our daily needs. Thank you for their work. Keep them safe and healthy. We pray for those who are preparing for school, both the students and the staff. We pray for the students that you would bless them. Keep them safe and keep them healthy this year. We pray that you would guide them and that they might learn the most important things in life, that they might be successful. We pray for those who are the teachers and the staff that meets with the kids day by day. I pray that you would bless them, keep them safe, and protect them from all these sicknesses that come through. And I pray that you would protect them also from the unnecessary regulations that come through. We pray for the administrators and those who work behind the scenes in the schools. We pray that you would bless them, help all of the staff needs to be met this year for our schools. We pray for those who are working in the hospitals, for the teachers, for the nurses, for the administrators, for the doctors. We pray that you would bless them, and for the aides that are working each day with the patients. I pray that you would bless them for their work. We pray that you would bring healing to the patients and comfort, help them to be able also to find you even during their times of trial. We pray for those who are serving as missionaries. We pray that you would bless them for their work. Provide for them as inflation eats away at their income. Help them as they travel, as there's many travel difficulties. We pray for those who are persecuted for their faith, those who are in prison for their faith. We ask that you would bless them and help them to share the good word of Jesus with those who are even trying to hurt them. Give them the strength and endurance that they need. We pray for those who are incarcerated. We pray that they would find Jesus. We pray that you would bless them, that they might be able to be reconciled to you and to their families and to the communities and share the good word of Jesus when they are released. Now we would pray the prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This time we'll receive your offering. Thank you. thank you for each giver, and we thank you for each gift. We pray that you would bless those who are giving. We pray that you would help us to reach the needs of this community through what has been given in these offerings today. Thank you for what you're going to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Seated. Now we're going to hear the gospel reading.
Today's gospel reading comes from the 12th chapter of Luke, verses 49 through 56. This is Jesus speaking. I have come to bring fire on the earth, and how I wish it were already kindled. But I have a baptism to undergo, and how distressed I am until it is completed. Do you think I came to bring peace on earth? No, I tell you, but division. From now on, there will be five in one family divided against each other. Three against two and two against three, they will be divided. Father against son and son against father. Mother against daughter and daughter against mother. Mother-in-law against daughter-in-law and daughter-in-law against mother-in-law. He said to the crowds, when you see a cloud rising in the west, immediately you say it's going to rain. And it does. And when the south wind blows, you say, it's going to be hot, and it is. Hypocrites, you know how to interpret the appearance of the earth and the sky. How is it that you don't know how to interpret this present time? Why don't you judge for yourselves what is right? As you are going with your adversary to the magistrate, try hard to be reconciled to him on the way, or he may drag you off to the judge, and the judge turn you over to the officer, and the officer throw you into prison. I tell you, you will not get out until you have paid the last penny. God's word for God's people.
Thank you so much, Jim, for your reading, and thank you, Gail, for your playing as always, and always when you bring the dulcimer, it adds in a special way and helps us to focus. Sometimes on some of those songs, we get to sing them over and over again, we forget to listen for the words and some of the melody, and we get caught up in just the way it was, but by bringing the dulcimer in, sometimes enlightens us in a new way, so thank you for bringing God's word in through music as we have heard. So, like a hammer, have you ever been doing something, maybe as a youth, maybe as an adult, that you know maybe isn't quite right, but you've been getting away with it, and all of a sudden, something happens. Maybe you've been speeding, and easing on speeding, and you get pulled over. Maybe you've been speeding and you hit a bump in the road where it says caution and you weren't cautious. Comes to mind, we used to see those in Mexico, these words totes. And it's like, what do totes mean? Well, they're big bumps in the road. And they're not just little speed bumps. These are ones that shape your teeth. And if you didn't pay attention to the word, you got the judgment. And maybe your wheel would fall off. I don't know. You hit them too hard, probably would. But they wanted you to slow down, and just people wouldn't pay attention to the signs, so they needed a little something to jar them. And that's the way God's word is, and that's the way sometimes it is for us, that we need something to jar us a little bit. How many of you little kids will get away with something for a while, and then your teacher or your parents would catch you, and all of a sudden a hammer came down? And you knew you really shouldn't be doing whatever it was. But you did it anyway because you haven't been caught yet. We see that all the time when people are flying past us on the interstate, and then they see a highway patrolman up, and all of a sudden we see brake lights come up, right? Because they know they shouldn't be speeding, they know that it's dangerous, they know all the statistics about the danger of speeding, but until there's a little bit of something to stop them, they won't. Israel had been blessed by God. They had been given peace on the sides. They'd been given great leadership. And for a while, they really worshiped God. They were so thankful when God got them out of fixes. They'd be so thankful. And then, after a while, began to fade. Well, you know the story. And judgment came. God didn't do it to cause harm to them or to make them miserable. He did it because what is important to God is not whether we have the best house or whether we have the best fields, but whether we have the best heart for God. So He has called us to be His children, and that's what He wants us to be. And Israel was specifically as a whole nation to be His children and His example, so that people could begin to see what God is like. And it takes a while to transform people from just being busy about their business people to busy about God and serving Him and allowing Him to work in their heart. So sometimes God had to bring His word like a hammer. Now, often His word is a comfort, and sometimes these psalms that we read are a real comfort to us. And He means it for that. In fact, when judgment comes, it isn't because that we're not loved by God, but it's because our behavior is going to lead us away in the wrong direction. Read in the Gospel where constantly in the Old Testament they were pointing out, even that psalm that we read alluded to Jesus coming. And here were these people that were so learned in the law, but here comes Jesus. Just like it said, and they can't see it. You can imagine how frustrated Jesus was that the people who were supposed to be right on and be leading the people couldn't even see it. They could see that it's going to rain. We're hoping that we'll get to see some signs of rain, right? Hoping we're going to get rain. But they couldn't see it when the most important event in the cosmos, Jesus coming to earth, was ignored because it didn't line up the way that they thought. They couldn't see the signs, and they couldn't put it together. And part of it is that they don't want to. When people get so busy, sometimes they don't want to have to pay attention to anyone. And face it, we all want to be our own little boss, don't we? We want to be, if you read the C.S. Lewis series, I don't know how many of you read his Out of the Silent Planet. Is the word of Yarsa? Is that the word? Or we want to be our own God. In another age, we talk about this. But so everyone wants to be their own God and run things the way they want to until we get a wall. I have to say I love clean energy. I love the idea of clean energy. And don't ever get me wrong that I don't want to see these things come true that they're talking about, where all we do is put up a solar panel and we get all the energy we need. We put up wind farms and we get all the energy we need. We run all of our equipment on it without polluting anything. And it's all renewable and we don't do anything wrong to the environment. I love that idea. In fact, I was riding my bicycle in the 70s because I thought we were going to get this nailed down. We had a movie when I was a kid, a film, and it was always a big thrill to have films because we didn't have, some of us didn't even have TV at home, but it was so good because they had one called Mr. Sun. Do any of you remember that besides me? Where they showed solar panels. That was back in the 60s. They could run solar panels onto a circuit where they couldn't get electricity. They could, like, people could have phones and things out in the middle of nowhere. And so we all thought those would keep getting better and better, and soon we would all be, we wouldn't have to pay for electricity, we'd just have our solar panels. Well, it hasn't worked that way, has it? And I feel like the judgment is kind of coming on that, that we have dreamed about all these ideas. I mean, I look on the internet all the time about these ideas for clean energy. But yet, when we see in Europe, when the spigot might be shut off for their natural gas, they're all concerned. And I think, well, this is a great opportunity for all these grand ideas to go forth. But they just don't have the means to make these come online yet. I think some of them are great ideas, but the magnitude didn't become apparent until the spigot gets shut off. Hopefully they won't freeze to death. Hopefully some solution will come out, but it's probably going to be that they get their fossil fuels from somewhere else. And I want them to show us how to do the clean energy. I want to see it done. But it's, so far we just don't have the technology. But I'm not concerned about the solar energy or the clean energy as much as I am about how they ignore God. Europe was really where a lot of the great theologians came from. A lot of the ideas were expressed where missionaries went out. And it seems like they said they don't need fossil fuels in Europe. Now they finally do. They also said they don't need God. Many of them, great atheists, are in Europe now. They don't need God. But maybe they do. Because I don't think it's because they don't like some of the rules, because the law of the Ten Commandments, who can argue against those? They just don't like the first one. Worship the Lord with all your heart and soul and mind. Because they want to go their own way. We see that in America now. A lot of people want to go their own way. God is okay, just let him stay in the church. Don't let him get into my life. Let him stay up high, long, far away. Or let him stay deep in our hearts. But don't let them change our life. Judgment may be coming for us, and even if it's not, trials will come no matter what. I tried to think of something creative for my illustration. I couldn't. Yeah. All right. So this is the one tool I feel confident using. It's not very good, but I try to do woodworking. I can't make things look right. Really can't do the wood. I see people do like nail art. It makes real pretty things out of nails and junk. I've got the junk. I just can't make it look right. Now we did get a wheel from Gale, and it's an old drill with those old iron wheels. And I was able to get part of it off, and I took it to a friend. And so that's about as close to art as I can get. But this hammer is really good. I can use this. I can get nails pushed in if I aim right. So we can do some construction with this hammer. This isn't a hammer that's like a sledge that's made to break up things. Although I've used these for this. How many of you use this as your universal tool? I know a lot of farmers have one of these in their box. And if nothing else works, at least you get satisfaction out of hitting something. Doesn't it feel good? I had a friend in Detroit, and he had a car back in the, if you remember back in the 70s, there were some awful cars that came out. When those automatic chokes came, they didn't get them quite right. Remember that? Well, he had one that would always die on him. It would go, always would die. And he got so mad at it one time, he got out of the car. He got his hammer and he just beat the thing to death. He beat it all over the place. And in Detroit, at that time, they just had people you called and they took their car away no matter what the shape was. And he said he beat that thing, beat the windshield out, beat everything. And he was heaving, holding the hammer, and he said, "Do I feel better now?" I think he did. But the hammer was not meant for this. This hammer is meant to build some things. And that's what God's Word is meant to do. to build God's house. And you are a part of God's house if you choose to do that. And sometimes the construction part doesn't go as smoothly as we might like. Some things need to be cut. Some things need to be redone. And that's the way it is with the church. Some nails need to be pulled out. Some need to be hammered back down. Something needs to be sawed off to make it fit. But God is working on His church even in these times like this. Even though we're going through trials, He's not just doing it to cause us pain. He's not doing it just to beat us with a hammer. He's doing it because He is building His church out of imperfect people. I got a long way to go. Every time I think I'm getting somewhere spiritually, I see how far I've got to go. I'm getting there, but God will reveal something that needs to be fixed. If you're seeking God's word each day, you see how far you need to go. But you're better off than you were. If you're following God's word, you're better off than you were. And God's church is better off than it was as we follow God's word. We just have a ways to go because we're not perfect. But someday, Jesus will come again. Now, a lot of things when we read about the kingdom of God, about Jesus coming, it was fulfilled to some degree at His first coming. We are the kingdom of God right now, whether we decide to accept that or not. We are part. We are the ambassadors. It is a group that is set apart from the world, but yet we are the kingdom of God. We're His representatives. And there are millions, if not billions, who are in His kingdom around the world. But there's still work to do. There's work to do on us. And God's word sometimes is like a hammer. And sometimes it's like a fire. And it doesn't mean that everybody's going to love it. Jesus knew when He preached that not everybody's going to like it, no matter how good this is. That it's going to stir up these families. And some of these people, for us, families aren't so close-knit as they were. But in those days, the family was your unit. It was your tribe. It was the ones who you came to. And the ones who you counted on. And when you split away from them and started believing something else, as many of the Christians did, it caused all kinds of problems. You can see today in some of the religions of today, people believe it causes some problems in the family. It causes not peace. If everyone would believe in Jesus, yes it would. He is the Prince of Peace. He wants to bring peace. Friends in India say that when someone becomes a Christian from a Hindu, it can stir up the family and people can disown them or cause problems with them. So He didn't come to bring peace in that way. He comes to bring us peace in our hearts and peace among those who will live according to His word. But not everybody's going to see it that way. Some will see that we're breaking away from what we've been taught. Some will be led by Satan to go after us just because we're following Jesus. You see it happening. What did they do wrong? Why are they in prison? There's a case in Iran where the guy believed and started making his message clear, and the police came and sent him to jail. I don't know where he's at today. He obviously can't get named because of the family. We pray for those people. Hopefully it doesn't get to that here today, but in the United States, but it may. It may get to that place. Because you can see that they can find reasons not to like the church because of what some people in the church do. So they can say, well, we just got to get rid of that organization. So are we ready? Have we built the foundation so that instead of being knocked down, we can be like those people in Hebrews? Now, if you read the whole chapter of chapter 11, you'll see that there were some people who didn't face the hammer. They didn't face persecution. They were blessed, such as Abraham and Noah. The hammer came, but he escaped, and others who preached the word that didn't suffer because they preached the word, but others did. So we need to make sure we're strong, because just like Jesus, when he suffered, he looked at the joy set before him. He is the author and finisher of our faith. So each day, each hour, if we can, let's look to Jesus. Let's let him do his work in us. Pull up those wild nails that are snagging things. Tap down those that are sticking out, that are causing problems. And build his church. Not the building, build his church among the people, that we might show the world who dwells in our house. Amen. The closing song is, God be the glory. Amen. 98 in your hymn book, verses 1 and 3. Now and forevermore. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.